gun violence in America. We really have a serious gun violence problem in this country. Hi, I'm Sam Walker, author of the book Sense and Nonsense About Crime. The 8th edition just appeared. It's been out for 30 years, and it speaks to this issue. In fact, we have two gun problems in this country. First, there are what are referred to as mass shootings. The shootings at schools, shopping malls, and so on, these make the headlines. The second problem are what we'll call street shootings. These are the routine, day-in, day-out shootings in our poor and high-crime neighborhoods. Now, the fact is, mass shootings are fairly rare, even though they get all the publicity. In 2012, one survey found that there were a total of 7. 66 people were shot and killed. Now, that's bad. That's serious. But it's nothing compared to the street shootings. So, for example, in 2013, in Chicago alone, 374 people were shot and killed. It's more than one a day. And the important part of that is that 90% of those people who were shot and killed were people of color. 90%. So it's about 70-some percent African-American, another 15% Latino. So our gun violence problem in terms of the street shootings is a race issue, and it's something that really needs to be addressed. Now, one important fact that really frames this whole issue is the fact that in this country, we have 100 million handguns in circulation. 100 million. This is an estimate by the Small Arms Survey, international group in Switzerland. They also estimate another 200 million long guns, rifles and shotguns. They're really not the problem in this country. Handguns are the issue. Now, the fact of with all of those guns in circulation, there is an enormous black market. If somebody wants a gun for some bad purpose, that person has no trouble getting it. In fact, the people who use guns for bad purposes, they don't buy their guns at retail stores. Only about 7% of the people in that category do. So we have to keep in mind the black market. Now, in terms of solutions, again, my book is titled Sense and Nonsense About Crime. Most of the proposed solutions really are nonsense. They're not effective. They don't address the real problem. Conservatives, their basic solution is more guns. They don't want gun control laws. They want open carry laws, and they support stand your ground laws. Again, more guns and really making them much more available. The liberal approach basically is fewer guns. Fewer guns in the hands of fewer people. And so they support gun control laws. Now, the Supreme Court has declared unconstitutional laws that ban the sale and possession of guns in particular cities. So that's really off the table. And so the liberal approach really focuses on restrictions on who can purchase a gun. Waiting periods, keeping them out of the hands of people with criminal records or recorded mental health issues. And so that's that approach. Now, the research indicates that, and all the evidence indicates, both approaches have failed. In terms of more guns, well, actually, we've been running a vast national experiment on more guns. That's what we have in our high crime neighborhoods, a lot of guns. And they're because they're available, they are used. In terms of the restrictions on who can purchase a gun, well, that approach has also failed, again, because of the black market and the number of guns that are available. If somebody wants a gun for a bad purpose, that person can get a gun. So, what to do? I mean, does nothing work? Do we have no hope at all? Actually, there is an effective approach. It's developed in the last few years as a police-based program. And the key term for this is focused deterrence. And it works in the following way. Police department, using all of its information sources, develops a very short list of known active gun criminals. Many are gang members and so on. Then it develops partnerships with other criminal justice agencies, state and federal, and with local private social service agencies. And it's really a multi-pronged approach. The key event are what are referred to as call-in meetings. So the people on the short list of known active gun criminals are called in or summoned to a meeting. Most of them are on probation and parole, so they can be commanded to appear. And they get a two-part message. First, law enforcement steps forward and says, we know who you are. We know what you're doing. We are going to focus our efforts on you, on if you break the law again, on arresting you and getting you off the street. And make it clear that they're going to be targeted even for minor offenses, like driving a car without a license or an unlicensed vehicle. Then social service agencies step forward and say, all right, if you want to get out of the life, you want to get out of the life of crime, out of the gang life, we have the services that can help, whether it's job training programs, basic education, substance abuse, dealing with family problems, and so on. Then it's followed up, and this is a key part. It has to be followed up by delivering on those promises. The social service agencies have to make those services available. And law enforcement follows up by, in fact, focusing on and arresting people on this list who do, in fact, violate the law. Now, I want to pause here and point out one of the virtues of focused deterrence and having a short list. It does not involve, you know, massive stops, frisks, arrests, harassment. First of all, those actions are illegal. They're unconstitutional. And second, they undermine, you know, trust in the community if you're stopping people who are not engaged in criminal activity. Now, the idea of focused deterrence really originated with the Boston Gun Project in the 1990s. It was evaluated. It's found to be effective. There have been several replications of the experiment. Probably the most important is in Cincinnati. The Cincinnati Initiative to Reduce Violence, CIRV. That was carefully evaluated, and there was a 41% reduction in gun violence among, you know, the people on the short list. And that was for a 3-year-plus time period. So the evidence, the best criminological research we have, indicates this approach works. It's the sense approach, not the nonsense approach to dealing with our gun violence problem. You might ask, well, why don't more departments have this? Because it's a challenge. It's a complex approach. It requires careful administration and strong leadership and follow-through and continuity. So it's difficult. But it really is a promising program, and it really is the solution to our major gun violence problem, which are the street shootings in our cities. Thank you.